I was actually playing in a band with Joe and Christian's dad. We tried to make money on a Monday nights in Lismore by setting up all our gear and doing a jam night. Phil and Chris rolled into town with their previous band, Crabapple, which is a pretty volatile bunch of guys, and they split up pretty quickly. And someone slipped me a demo of their old band, and I kind of liked what I heard. So I asked them to join my band. Having the cameras around has been okay.
Well, it's good and bad, I guess. But no, it's been fun.
As long as it's on all the time.
Sometimes the camera can be a little bit obtrusive, invading.
So it's pretty natural, probably a bit too natural.
I think it's going to be really a good little DVD by the end of it all, so that's the main thing.
I mean, it was totally unexpected, selling that many copies of that record. You know, we just thought, mate, if we sell 10,000 copies of this record, we're going to be stoked.
We all thought we were rock gods all of a sudden, and realised that we were so at the bottom of the hill.
I don't really remember it at all. Like, it's such a long time ago, and when I listened to that record, it just seems, a really, really long time ago. Young as 19 or 20, and your liver can stand anything back then. And I didn't really feel like anyone wanted a piece of me. I was just doing a gig, and it was at the time where a lot of Aussie bands were going really well, like Supervision and Living End and Jebediah as well. We were going really, really good. So it was just, where was this groundswell of really good bands that came out.
We sold 100,000 of that first record that we did, and I think we all thought this is going to be easy. You know, this will be easy. We'll go to America. Blow up and do it pretty easy, maybe some sort of semi-Silverchair sort of story or something, and so wasn't going to turn out like that, and hasn't turned out like that, and it's been a lot of hard work to get to here, and here's a good place to be so far.
We just kind of do what we do. We just write a bunch of songs and then put them on the record. There is, you know, the record company has a bit of input for the songs that go on the record, and so does management and stuff. But at the end of the day, like, especially on the last record, there was no major disagreements about that. I think we all were pretty much on the same page.
It's pretty cutthroat.
You do have to compromise sometimes. You can't be you can't be a dictator.
Yeah, I don't think there's really many outside forces apart from us wanting to write like a number one worldwide smash hit.
You know, we work for a record company. You know, at the end of the day, if we were an independent band, we could do whatever the hell we want, but that's not the path that we've chosen. You know, we have a lot of creative control. I mean, there's no one at our record company who's got any idea about music anyway, so we can basically do whatever we want.
Phil, for a record, would probably write 50 songs or something like that, and out of that we'll pick like 5 or something, so you know, he's got thick skin. Yeah, we ace a lot of his material, but you know, the stuff he comes out with, I mean, it was pretty good. Pat's pretty different. He comes up with like one and it's killer and that's it. And Joe's sort of in between them two. But together as a team, we sort of get in there and just nut them out once we actually select a few of them. Nut them out until we're sort of happy with them and go from there.
Weeks, I think.
We've just been touring in the States for like the last 18 months and stuff, and we probably were burnt out and out of control, and we were going through an interesting phase.
We'd written a lot of material on the road in the States, so we probably only had really seven decent songs. And we'd already been booked to play the big day out, so we needed to record it and get it out so we could do the big day out. And kind of a bit of a mess, really. I still love the record, but I'm pretty proud of it.
You get a rock band, you get them to play really loud, and then you make it sound a bit louder, and you're done.
Working with Burnside was an experience. He's a really interesting guy. I look back at that with fond memories. I have not seen the guy since.
Like that. It looks very familiar.
Burnside was great to work with, and we had a great time with him. He was put under a lot of pressure as well to get the record finished, and there was late nights, and we didn't see eye to eye all the time, but he's a great producer and, you know, a good friend.
So I don't know about bits in the beginning, what do you reckon?
The bits of opening the song?
Yeah.
Well, it sounded really good on the demos.
Yeah, we're pretty much doing the same thing.
Yeah, in a way.
Well, I can get this last part right.
Yeah, get the last part right. We'll have a look at the start. Yeah.
Punch me in at the beginning of the solo.
He kind of got us when we'd just come back from overseas and we were being pressured into writing an album, which was easy, and we didn't really know what direction we wanted to head in. He was the knock-off at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, go and have beers, and then go back into the studio. It was all a bit of a party.
Pretty much a drug haze all the way through it. Everyone was just getting wasted all the time. I think for the whole of that recording session, I was wasted. Yeah, I don't remember much of the recording process.
It was at the end of the American tour. I was really wasted, actually, a little bit.
It was 2 weeks before we recorded Easy.
And we're all pretty agitated with each other. It was all getting a bit much. We needed a little break, and I think Joe and Phil had a bit of a scuffle on stage.
Yeah, we'd just gotten back from the States. We'd had like 1 or 2 days at home, and then we took off for New Zealand, and we're doing this stupid big air comp.
Incidences went down. Me and Joe had been sharing, we'd all been sharing a Winnebago for the past 6 months on the Warped Tour. I actually forget the situation, but we were really strung out. Like it was, you know, make or break time.
We were playing at the bottom of a big air snowboarding ramp. It was live on their music channel in New Zealand, and so it had like 5,000 people each side of this big air ramp that came down like this. And it ended right at the front of the stage, and we had snowboarders coming up and landing on stage, and it was all crazy and extreme sports and stuff. It was a pretty, pretty mental.
This PA had the guy announcing the snowboarders jumping over the PA, like through as we were playing the music. So it would be like, you know, whatever song's going on. Oh, here comes so-and-so doing a fakey 540, whatever. And I was like, this is shit.
It was really, I feel very embarrassed about it, to be perfectly honest. It's not, I love Joe. Like, really, really sad that I did it. And it was a really cheap shot.
It was kind of blown out of proportion in a way. Like, I think we were just really on edge. And I threw my bass at him. And then as I was picking it up, he didn't really like that, which I can totally understand. Yeah, I was just playing away and it was just like my nose was just bleeding, like blood everywhere. And it was all in my arm, my bass and everything, and I couldn't even keep playing the notes because like blood's really sticky and it was just, my fingers were sticking to the thing and I was just like, well, this is fucked, I'm off. So I walked off and then I went back and punched a couple of sort of like trailers, you know, and the big angry punch, oh, fuck this. And didn't put a dent in them, but it was really funny. All these big, huge Maori bouncers are looking at me going, look at this little guy going.
Me and Pat were left up on stage playing this song still by ourselves, and we're like, okay, we better stop now. Yeah, so we finished five songs into the set.
Rock and roll, it's dangerous. It's a dangerous business.
What didn't kill us made us grow stronger, and, you know, that's kind of... It was the lowest point of the band, in my opinion. The crowd were just stunned. They didn't know what the fuck happened. And you know, like, I guess every band has them, but not necessarily on stage. So, anyway, nothing I can do about it. You know, I'm not proud of it.
In hindsight, it's actually kind of good that those moments happen in a way. Probably not on stage, and probably not the punching and stuff, just the hugging bits. But no, it's not the only time we've had a tussle. So, you know, it may not be the last even.
He seemed to, you know, nip everything in the bud pretty early. And we're still here and still doing it, and we're all still great mates, which is a good thing. Because I highly doubt you could be in a band and do this if you weren't good mates.
Tim Rogers said to me that, you know, it's an amazing just to make a second album, let alone three or four, you know, to have the same people. It's like, you know, you don't know how hard that is. And he's right, you know, it's really hard to find three guys that will, like, make music with you for that amount of time and still be your friend.
Working on New Detention was fantastic. The songs I thought were really good. They came to me along with Peter Billing sending me a bunch of demos which we shortlisted and then did pre-production on.
We love Phil. We love Phil so much. I don't think we're ever going to leave Phil.
We've worked with Phil McKellar from the very beginning when we first got unearthed and we recorded Sickfest. He came up to Lismore and we recorded it up there. And kind of built a relationship from there, you know. We've got similar tastes in movies and that kind of stuff, and we understand his sense of humour and he understands us.
He's the doctor. He's very scientific and lovely and always is really positive.
He knows how we work and, you know, knows our limits and can push us past them.
We've got a similar kind of ideas about what's good and what's bad, and although some of his ideas are pretty out there, sometimes we have to sort of like settle him down a little bit. He gets a bit overexcited.
Just, you know, we'll nail it, we'll do it, you know, just we'll get it done. There's never any, we can't do it, he doesn't freak out at all, which I do all the time.
Just seem to work together well, and it's just good energy to have around.
Commercial success is not just the only thing that drives them. You know. Like, they do have a pretty solid sense of integrity and how they want to achieve their music. I think it was pretty cruisy, really. I don't think, you know, the record company didn't have much to worry about except the fact that the drummer had potentially, you know, ruined his career. I get a call or whatever sort of saying, oh, Chris has had a major accident, put his hand through a window and severely damaged a tendon. So that was the phone call I got, and it's like, oh my God, what's happened to him, and where's this record gonna go? Or at least with the drummer. He'd be bound up for maybe 4 or 5 weeks, and the bandages would come off then, and we'd see. So I guess it was, you know, a pretty scary moment when, you know, that the bandages come off, the doctors sort of inspected his arm, and I guess the real test would be when he jumped on a drum kit. And he was back smashing those drums, so that was amazing. You know, sort of recovery turnaround, yeah. Can get started. Chemical heart. You know, there's sort of still, in a way, without sounding like a cliche, but still sort of, you know, rock and roll outlaws or renegades in that, you know, like, they're a band that are loved or hated. They're not sort of a band that's tolerated or, you know, like, people think, oh yeah, they're okay. They're either definitely loved or loathed. They're sort of uncompromising in their views, I think, and the way they present themselves.
We have toured a lot, like we've done years where we've done 200 gigs in a year, but not as much anymore.
I like doing regionals. It's good. I like that part of touring. I don't think we've never been a band who'd play Sydney, play the Metro, go to Melbourne, play the Forum, and that's it. You know, go to Brisbane and play the Arena. I mean, how boring would that be? Got to meet the people.
We do go to those places because people buy records there, and it's fun. It's fun to see Australia.
Ladies and gentlemen,
it's just really enjoyable to play to fans out in the middle of nowhere that haven't seen you for a year or something. We've changed a bit and we've got new songs and all that. And they go nuts. They love it.
They go crazy, you know. They save up for it and, you know, and hopefully we do it justice.
I'm a very big Grinspoon fan.
When's the last time you saw them?
A Saturday night. It's the 19th in Adelaide at Sebi Theatre. Before that in Melbourne, before that back in Adelaide, before that Wyala, before that Adelaide, before that Mount Gambier, before that Adelaide, before that Melbourne, before that Paul's Festival. Before that Adelaide, do you want me to keep going?
The only time I ever really get nervous on a plane is when we're like descending. You know, like doing the old circular motion thing. Oh, what do they call that? Patterns? Some shit. I hate like not landing. I hate want to get there and land on the ground.
If you got sick of travelling, give up being in a fucking band because, you know, it's so much a part of it. I think towards the end of the tour you get a bit tired, but you know. It's all part and parcel. It's good.
Water and the shoes would be great.
So essentially, the Caravan of Courage is all about the smokers, and because we all smoke in this car.
This is the first partnership that is really all about the smokers.
Yeah, well they smoke a different kind of pole.
They smoke a different kind of pipe.
They smoke flesh pipe.
Flesh pipe.
Yeah, so yeah. That's what Chris is a pretty wacky dude. He drives really fast, which is good. Doesn't fuck shit up. Well, Davo is the navigator, but I don't do anything whatsoever. Where do you think they're going?
We got the two cars going, and that's when it became the fun ship in the caravan.
You got to be pretty courageous to get in that car, because Chris drives about 180 most of the time. It's totally safe, he reckons. He says, "No, I can see, like, you know, 2 kilometres as a straight road. I can see, like, 2 km's in front, you know." Our point was about, like, maybe possible stray kangaroo or emu or something.
It's good. It's really keeps the touring fun, and we race them, and we always beat them, and then we laugh at them when they get there, and they're like, "Well, we stopped here and got this. Well, that was kind of cool." But I couldn't travel in the Festa.
We just go from A to B as quickly as possible, and then we chill.
We drive at 200 kilometres an hour along the pave lanes.
On one trip, I lost my whole licence in one hit. It was a public holiday. I got booked twice on the way up to Byron, booked once on the way back, added up the points when I got home, and it was 13 or something. So
I reckon every town in Australia has something good about it. Sometimes you got to search for it, but they do. Even Lismore has something good about it, I've heard.
Like, it's unfair, especially on Joe, because he gets really sick from cigarette smoke, so he's smoking in the car. So I don't think we'll ever be able to go back. We just love it too much.
Also, you got to be courageous, because it's full of smoke. Phil's in there as well, so you got to be pretty courageous, you know, like, he generally is asleep on the back seat without a seatbelt, with maybe like a little sausage roll stuck in the corner of the, sort of in the corner there, and maybe a bit of milkshake, bit of McDonald's, Hungry Jack's or something. So there's all sorts of odours you got to be quite courageous with as well. So yeah.
Joe's pretty quiet. Sometimes he's the band trasher guy. I mean the band room trash guy. Look, here's the pigs.
Suck it.
Nice work.
That was really good. Fresh out of the 80 zone, straight into a cop. We won't see one again now, so we can travel at 180.
Yeah, Sean is a interesting character. We met him on New Year's Eve, I think it was 2001, when he drove us down to the Falls Festival, and I just didn't think he'd want to work with us after that. The drive home was insane. Me and Pat had too much of everything, I guess, and we didn't stop talking the whole way, trying to talk over each other, but we both thought we were funnier than than what he was saying, kind of thing, and it was all directed at Sean.
Whereas today in the fun ship, you'll find. So, should we stop for coffee?
It'll take us 2 hours to get out of Adelaide.
That's our war cry. When are we going to have coffee?
Well, I rang up Greg, our manager, and next I said, "Look, we really need a tour manager, and I hope that guy wants to keep working with us, because I wouldn't after what happened last night." And he was cool about it, and he's just always maintained his cool. I've never seen him angry or lose his sort of cool. He's always just been a very steady, calming, fatherly figure for Grinspoon.
Flavoured water.
And, like, he gets lost sometimes, but that's okay. He's not the fastest driver, but that's fine too.
They're there.
Yeah, fucking idiots.
We're in Albury.
And where are they?
Naranda, they went up over here. We just came down to Albury. And they did the big fucking across New South Wales run.
Okay, well,
they're hours behind us. Yeah, we're definitely a routine. Yeah. I share with Chris. Phil shares with Joe. I drive with Chris and Joe. Chris and Phil. Joe drives with the accountant and the merch guy.
Best thing about touring is looking for food places in towns like this. It's definitely a challenge. You can often find the old dodgy kebab shop, but I'm a bit over that now.
We smoke. We do drugs, we drink, you know.
I don't know. There's nothing to eat in this town except oranges. We're in orange country.
Yeah, just gaming in the rooms, smoke lots of cigarettes. I mean, my day consists of 23 hours of waiting around every day.
Worried about having to wait at this fucking airport for so long, man.
Take it out with a 1-2 punch.
It's never really crossed my mind that it wouldn't happen, and that sounds kind of arrogant or presumptuous, but it's what it, I don't know what it's cracked up to be, because I've always thought I'd be playing to people.
We do what we do. We write music that sounds like Grinspoon. I think when you hear us on the radio, you can't, it's hard to mistake us for someone else. I think that's important.
I never really considered myself a rock star, I'm an artist. Craig Nichols of mine's.